welcome to the 2016 Celebration of Black History, a conversation with living legends, hosted by our own interim CEO, Lee May, and DeKalb County Government. Today, you will have the opportunity to dialogue with some of the most influential individuals of the civil rights movement. As the program begins and throughout the program, please be sure to tweet your questions using the hashtag DeKalbBHP. That's DeKalb, B as in Black, H as in History, P as in Paul, DeKalbBHP. Please refrain from using any vulgar or derogatory language when tweeting your question, as this event is being streamed live on your own Emmy Award-winning station, DCTV Channel 23. Now I ask you all to please rise for the presentation of colors from the DeKalb County High School of Columbia High School, JROTC, and the Pledge of Allegiance from Cedar Grove High School's own student government president.
Ms. Quinique Williams, I am the junior class president at Cedar Grove High School. You guys are already standing, so let's say the pledge to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. You may now be seated.
Thank you again. That was Columbia High School's JROTC. Here now to provide the welcome and the occasion for today's event is DeKalb County Interim CEO Lee May.
Good morning. Good morning. How's everyone doing this morning? It is good to see your beautiful faces, the energy in this room as we are celebrating Black History Month here in DeKalb County. My name is Lee May. I'm the interim CEO here in DeKalb County, and I'm just excited to be here with you all as we are honoring, celebrating, acknowledging the history of those who have sacrificed on our behalf, who have literally given blood, sweat, and tears for our freedoms here in DeKalb County, in the state of Georgia, in America, in the world, frankly. And today is really a day that we wanted to bring in literally some living legends, people who fought during a period of time in our history where everyone didn't have the same rights and privileges as everyone else. There were times that people just couldn't enjoy life the way other people could. And for the students here, the ones that are from our DeKalb County high schools, all the ones who are present here and will be coming as well. You know, I really wanted to bring together an event that can really communicate some of the things that have gone on in our history and you be able to hear them from the people that actually lived it out, that had to drink out of black-only water fountains, that had to ride on the back of the bus, that couldn't enjoy the same public school facilities as their white counterparts. These are people that actually lived that. And you may listen to history and read history, and you may see these names. You know, you always hear about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., a great American, a great Atlanta native. But it was him and others that worked together. And because Dr. King is dead, I think a lot of times you all and we all think that that was so long ago that we don't have a direct connection with the things that went on during that period of time. So today is meant to bring that connection closer, because it really wasn't that long ago. It wasn't that long ago where there was, you know, separate but equal. Y'all, separate is not equal. And the laws had to be changed to say that no, separation is not okay. It is not equal. And the laws had to be changed. And it was through the struggles and fights, the changing of laws, the marching, the boycotting that occurred during those times over the past 50, 60, 70 years that allows us to sit in a facility like this, that allows me to sit in a position of leadership like I am right now, that allows there to be a superintendent like Dr. Stephen Green, who is leading our DeKalb County school systems, to be in place to make sure that we're providing a quality education for all of our kids, for all of you all. So today is about honoring the past, celebrating the past, but using that as a foundation to move forward in the future, to create a dynamic environment and culture, a county, a state, and a nation for us. And you all, DeKalb County high school students, you all have a direct impact in that. And I'm going to end with this. You all have heard the old adage that the youth are our future. Y'all have heard that before? Y'all believe that? That's a partial truth and it's a partial lie. Because a lot of times when you hear people say that the youth are our future, that's really someone older telling you to go sit in a corner right now and your time will come in the future. But I'm here to tell you right now, your future is now, and you have a direct impact on our right now, on the history right now, on our present day right now. And today we want you to listen, to learn, to interact, to ask questions from these living legends that you'll hear about earlier, and they'll be introduced. But we're excited today, and I'm excited about you and excited about your future. So welcome you all. Welcome to DeKalb County. Welcome to the Port of Sanford Performing Arts Center. This is a phenomenal facility here. I'm thankful for all the participants that are on the agenda. And you all are in for a treat today, a blessing. And not just that you get to skip school for a few hours, but you all are in for a treat for some good wisdom that you're going to hear today. So I'm about to get off the stage, but I'm going to bring up one who I think is one of the best school superintendents in the nation that we have right here, Dr. Stephen Green, who is providing leadership for our 100,000+ students, who is your superintendent, who is making sure that you have a quality education. And I'm excited to call him a friend and a peer in leading this county moving forward. Dr. Green.
Thank you, Mr. May, CEO May, Interim CEO May. Let's give him a round of applause. He's put this together. I want to thank him personally and professionally for putting this. This is the inaugural event for this year where we have intergenerational, this young, older or veteran experience like me, and our young people and our future coming together on behalf of the future of this community and the future of our nation. I applaud you. So first of all, before I begin my greetings, let me give honor and praise and glory to God, thanking him for allowing us to be together on this day. And I'm reminded of Philippians 4:13, I can do all things that are possible through him. And without him, I'll add nothing is possible. But on behalf of the DeKalb County School District, might I add, DeKalb County fully accredited school district, fully accredited. I bring you greetings. I think we have an opportunity here, a rare opportunity, but a great opportunity to celebrate, to commemorate, and to educate. We will have the opportunity to celebrate what we have achieved thus far in our journey and our struggle, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. We have an opportunity to commemorate those on whose shoulders we have stood to make the strides for justice that we have made to date, knowing there's more to be accomplished, much more. And then we have the opportunity to educate. We have the opportunity to educate the next generation who must be ready, who must be willing, and must be able to stand in the gap and engage in the struggle for freedom, the struggle for justice, the struggle for equality, the struggle for opportunity, the struggle for prosperity. And so they must be armed and ready. And this is a part of getting them armed, getting you, my young people I'm looking at, armed and ready. And you do need to be armed and ready to stand for justice. The struggle is ongoing. The struggle never ends. In fact, I'm reminded of the words as I speak to you today. I'm reminded of the words of Frederick Douglass. And you and many of you have read these words, but I'm going to say it again because it is the struggle that we have gone through. And some of the icons you're going to hear from today, the struggle that they have gone through, we have inherited that struggle, but we have turned that struggle into refining and as a weapon for justice. And so Frederick Douglass reminds us that if there is no struggle, there's no progress. And those who profess favor of freedom, yet deprecate the agitation of men and who want crops without plowing the ground, they want rain without the thunder and lightning, they want the ocean without the awful roar of its mighty waters. This struggle may be a moral one. It may be a physical one. It may be both a moral and a physical struggle, but it must be a struggle. And power concedes nothing without demand. It never did, and it never will. So on behalf of this intergenerational gathering, those who have gone before us, those who are standing in the gap now, and those who are going to stand in the gap in the future, I bring you greetings on what we have done, what we're doing, and what we're going to do. And I ask you to participate in this and glean and squeeze every bit out of it you can intellectually, socially, emotionally. Squeeze what you can out of it and take it to task and take it forward in the future. I applaud this event taking place. I hope it's the first of many. And as we continue our fight, and again, it is a fight for the future. As we continue this struggle, may you engage with us and may you take us forward into the next generation that will come behind you. Thank you so very much.
Please now welcome to the stage Mr. Jamie Jinks of McNair High School for our invocation.
Good morning. May we stand, please? And you may intercess how you may. You can hold hands with your neighbor if you like. But let us pray. Lord, your children has gathered on today just to say thank you. Thank you for a chosen generation. And thank you for an enriched history of the civil rights historians and people who gathered here today. Thank you for such time like this that you were able to wake us up at this point in time. Thank you for the man hours and lives sacrificed for the people to stand here today. And Lord, as we pray in your holy name, you educate a youth such as myself to empower and to keep our people alive. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Please remain standing and join hands for the singing of the Negro National Anthem presented by Miss Kiara Mahoney.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that our dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that our presence has brought us. Facing the rising sun of a new day begun, let us march on till victory is won.
Please take your seats. Now we'll have a special dramatic presentation featuring DeKalb County youth, produced right here at the Porter Sanford III Performing Arts and Community Center by Dwayne Boyd's Premier Actors Network.
Come on, guys, you guys have got to keep up with the group, okay?
Okay.
Go ahead.
What's the point?
Of what? Learning about all this ancient stuff. These dates are old, the people are old, it's the past. Just how does this help now?
Wait a minute, what? You can't be serious, don't you get it? Learning about our history helps us understand why things are the way they are so we can make a difference when we grow up.
Come on. How are some old people gonna help me with what's relevant now?
Let me show you. Didn't you tell me you wanted to run for mayor one day? Let me introduce you to
CEO Lee May.
Whoa!
Pleased to make your acquaintance. Sean, you have been giving Alex some pretty solid advice.
You know our names?
Why, of course, and you know mine. Today, you can call me Lee. Alex, I heard you say learning the past is a thing of the past. Did I hear that right?
You see, Mr.
Lee.
Yes, Lee. I mean, Mr. Lee. I was just saying, you know well, that history isn't exactly the present. I didn't mean to offend anyone.
You'd be surprised what us old folks have to offer. We can learn a lot from each other. Do you know what I'm famous for?
The youngest DeKalb County Chief Executive Officer.
That's right, Sean. And it was all due to the efforts of the people from the Civil Rights Movement, like one of my personal heroes, Reverend Joseph Lowery, who fought for choice, change, and equality. He helped me when I was not much older than you two and supported my ambitions. Do you think it would have been possible without all the hard work from the people from the past?
I guess not.
If that's not cool, I don't know what is.
Sean, you sound very eager. Tell me. What have you two done lately to help in your community?
We're only kids.
Even kids can make a difference. Just helping one person is enough. Think about it and get back to me.
That was uber cool. You know what this guy?
Oh yes, just wait, it gets even better.
You hear that?
Up here.
Hi.
Allow me to introduce myself. I am J.T. Johnson, as it reads on my plaque.
You jumped in a pool. What good did that do?
Sometimes you have to make one big boat splash to make waves. I don't do much swimming now. I've been helping out my community as a booming voice of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, SCLC.
So you're telling me if I jump in a pool, then I can make a difference?
Well, it depends on the pool.
It was whites only.
Well, that made a big difference. Tell me, kids, what's your bold splash?
It's like the past is present. He's history, but doing stuff now. It's like simultaneously current and past. And what does that make the future?
Well, mind-bending.
Have you looked in the mirror?
Rita Jackson Samuels.
You read well, but how's your hearing?
Huh?
Ma'am?
You asked about the future. Do you look in the mirror? You see, Alex and Sean, you're the past and the future.
Okay, now you're really pulling my leg.
No, Alex, I think what she means is we're part of history, too.
Precisely. For instance, there was a time when women, like your grandmother or mother, were not treated fairly. Now, at that time, that was my present. But in order to change the future, I started the Georgia Coalition of Black Women. I fought very hard for women's rights then, so someone like your sister can be treated fairly now. Understand?
Wait a minute. There's no reason to bring the crybaby into this. Now, are you telling me when I look in the mirror at 12, I'll see the future, like see me in the future?
You've almost got it.
What do you think your future self expects of you?
To be the best person in our community right now.
Precisely.
Oh, the weight. My future self has got to give more answers. These aren't just old people. They're doing stuff to help our community right now.
Tell me about it. I knew history was important, but I didn't know people were still making history.
Those people could be you.
Oh, man, you're Dr. C.T. Vivian.
You know him?
Know him. He's the reason I can go to college. He created the Upward Bound Scholarships Program.
Oh, right. Mrs. Crayer told us about him. Didn't you march with Martin Luther King and meet Barack Obama?
You're both correct. Happy are you both so excited about history. Considering it seemed as though history had no importance earlier, especially you, Alex.
Yeah, but you're doing stuff to help us now.
And where do you think that started?
Here we go. From the past self, talking to the present self to help the future self. I get it.
Or something like that.
Right, something like that. You see, after working in the civil rights movement, I saw there was a need, not only for the current youth, but we needed to think about our
future.
Correct. Education is important for your future. It all sums up to the present you. You are the difference in your community. You can either help or hurt it through your action or non-action.
Hey, wait, can you tell us how? How are we the difference? What are we supposed to do?
I'm sure we can figure it out. We just have to talk to our future selves in the mirror.
Trust me, it'll talk back.
Who said that?
I know that convincing voice. You're the Trumpet Awards founder and first Southern African American woman to host a primetime talk show. I watch the Trumpet Show every year.
What are you doing right now to ensure you're on that show every year?
Okay, seriously, there's like major celebrities on the show.
Yes, but there are far more community leaders awarded each year.
What am I supposed to do to get on the show? I'm only a kid.
Create your legacy now. Do what you feel is best. Start small. Be a blessing to someone else every day. I promise, all your hard work and efforts will add up. You'll see that doing the work is rewarding enough.
Wow, man, she's a legend. Alex, what are you doing?
Talking to my future self.
Yeah, well, what's it say?
I'm a living legend.
Only in your imagination.
Exactly where it starts.
What happened to Ben? Oh. We've been looking for both of you. The bus almost left. Come on, we can expect me to be back.
That's not so bad.
Where'd they go?
To change the world.
All right, let's give it up again for that stellar performance by Dwayne Boyd's Premier Actors Network, housed right here at the Porter Sanford III Performing Arts and Community Center.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Crystal McLeod. I attend Cedar Grove High School. I am a junior. I have the pleasure of introducing Mr. Ryan Cameron. He is a two-time Emmy Award winner. You hear him every morning on the V103. He is a member of the Georgia Radio Hall of Fame. He is the host of the number one morning show in Atlanta. He is a father, a son, and a husband. Please put your hands together for Mr. Ryan Cameron.
So, I saw people coming in, right? And I was saying to them, you know, y'all are late, so y'all should, like, calm down a little bit. It was a little rowdy. I said I was going to recognize the fact that there are a lot of people in this room who have not figured out what they want to do. They don't know where they're going to go. They don't know if they're going to college. They don't know if they're going to do a trade. They have no idea. There's always the people in the front. They know all the answers, right? Then there's the people in the back who don't care. And then there's the people in the middle who are still trying to figure it out. Now, which one are you? If you're in the front, make some noise. If you're in the back and you just here so you don't get fined, make some noise. It's always one. That's what I'm saying. Be honest. And if you're in the middle and you're trying to figure it out, that's what I was. Trying to figure it out. Didn't know what I wanted to do. If it's just you and your mama, make some noise. I was that raised by a single parent person. Had never had anybody in my family go to college, but I was the first senior class president at my high school, Campbell Smyrna. There was only 14 black people in the whole class of 300. I was the president of my fraternity, Kappa Alpha Psi at West Georgia College. I was the president of Black Greek Council at West Georgia College. I'm the first African-American PA announcer in the history of the Atlanta Hawks. I'm a member of the Georgia Radio Hall of Fame, but I was also the one that was a class clown. So if you can turn that fooly wang into being a leader, then you're on to something. So before Snapchat and Twitter and Instagram and everything else, you have to decide if you're here to meet history or become history. See, I know it's easy to come in here and just clown and cut up, but we about to bring the people who sat and who marched and who were there, because y'all see the videos, it's all in black and white. These people were right next to Dr. King. So if I ask you, are you Dr. Martin Luther King? And you say, yes, I am, and I just smack you. You have to practice nonviolence because it happened. And you're going to hear Xernona Clayton tell you about that story. Nonviolence is a practice. Dr. King was not killed because of racial injustice. He was killed because he wanted economic equality. We spend $1.8 trillion a year, black people. You know when we spend most of the money? In December, buying Christmas gifts. Now, what if we turn all that money into some development like this beautiful building? You want to give it up for this beautiful building in your own neighborhood? Today, we're going to bring these legends up. I want you to give them the respect that they deserve, because you remember this day. You'll say, I was there. I remember when the person came to my school. You remember coming to this Port of Sanford auditorium and seeing these people today. And remember, it's great to be a part of the problem. That's so easy, because you got your crew. I saw when they said, hey, hold hands. That don't mean nothing. All these people marched arm in arm, hand in hand, together, for the reason you're able to do what you're doing today, but you don't know that. So today, I ask you to put down the phone for just a second. Just a second. Just a second. I know you're tweeting. I just need an example. Because the iPhone 6 ain't going to get you into college. It might get you killed. Huh? There are people out there would rather take your phone and take your life than help you on the side of the road if you run out of gas. Can I get a witness? There are many people who could not be here today, but they wanted to send this video message. So before I bring them out, those who are present, I wanted you to watch this video, and then we'll start.
In early March of 2015, the world descended upon the small rural town of Selma, Alabama. Nobody turned me around. All ages, races, religions joined hand in hand, tracing the very footsteps which led to a revolution of hope, justice, and equality for all. From the children of those who paved the way,
they did not know if they were going to die or not, and many had already been killed.
Just like they had to fight and die, we might not have to fight and die, but we certainly have to be aware.
To celebrities and those returning back to the place they once marched, this time with their own children, all walking in solidarity with those who blazed a trail toward social change and equality just 5 decades ago across this very bridge.
we made a decision. Jose William, working with Dr. King and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, led that march and asked me to lead it with him.
While this anniversary march commemorates one historic event, there are those civil rights legends whose very lives breathed spirit into the entirety of a movement which created equality and the very possibility of such accomplishments as African Americans in political positions. Lee May, the youngest person to serve as chief executive in DeKalb County, Georgia, spoke with two such legends of the civil rights movement about the passage of the generational torch to serve and that very historic day in Selma.
We came to the highest point on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, crossing the Alabama River. Down below, we saw a sea of blue, Alabama State Troopers. And Jose said, "Major, give us a moment to kneel and pray." And the man said, "Troopers, again, advance." And I said, "Major, may I have a word?" He said, "There will be no word." And you saw these guys putting on their gas masks. They came toward us, beating us with nightsticks and bullwhips, trampling us with horses and releasing the tear gas. I was left bloody and unconscious on the bridge. I thought I saw death. I thought I was going to die on that bridge.
But instead, the determined, nonviolent 25-year-old lived to become known as the conscience of Congress, having served since 1987. A young person himself during the civil rights movement, Congressman John Lewis's life serves as a leadership roadmap to enacting change, policy, and progress.
Did you ever think that you would see a day such as this where you would be leading in the halls of Congress and we would have an African-American president?
I never dreamed that one day I would live to see an African-American president, or I would live to see myself in the Congress. When President Barack Obama was elected, I cried. People stood in a movable line. And when people tell me today nothing has changed, I just feel like saying, "Come and walk in my shoes. I will show you."
Lending his voice and faith during the historic inauguration of our country's first African-American president was Reverend Dr. Joseph Lowry, known as the Dean of the Civil Rights Movement.
The movement generated the kind of spirit and change that made it possible for him to be elected.
Yeah.
And he was a smart dude. He ran a beautiful race.
Yes, he did.
And not many people believe he could win.
Yeah.
But he did.
But he did. That's right. That's right.
Help us then now, Lord, to work for that day when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, when tanks will be beaten into tractors, when every man and every woman shall sit under his or her own vine and fig tree, and none shall be afraid.
Beaten by a white police officer at just 12 years old, Lowry dedicated his life to racial justice and nonviolence, including helping to create the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, or SCLC.
We knew that that wasn't the way things were supposed to be. We did separate schools, separate seats on the bus, separate everything. We knew it was wrong. And we were determined to see it. And so we asked God to help us, and God blessed us with his presence. And we went through many dangers, toils, and snares. And a lot of people lost their lives. But we came out triumphant.
Well, talking about historic, did you ever think that your efforts would literally change the course of history?
I think I have to admit that we did not recognize how gigantic the motion would be, the movement would be. But we knew we were doing right, and we trusted God.
Yes.
And we kept on kept on, as the boys said, kept on keeping on. And it was a great experience. I hope the young people who are with us today will see the beauty and joy of movement, of doing the right thing for the right reason, and that they will pick up the mantle where we left off, because the struggle is not over.
And as moments of the civil rights movement continue to be acknowledged on critical anniversary dates, it's the spirit of the movement to enact service-driven action, which these icons say will be their greatest medal of honor should the next generation of leaders accept the torch to serve.
We used what we had. And I would say, never, ever give up or give in or give out. When you see something that is not right, not fair, and not just, speak up. Speak out. You're never too young to get involved.
I was willing to pay the price, and I hope you'll do the same, and I hope your children will do the same. And we must work for that day when black will not be asked to get back.
Yes.
When brown can stick around.
Yeah.
When yellow can be mellow, when the red man can get ahead, man, and when white will embrace what is right, that's what we're working for.
All right.
That's what the young people have to take up a challenge.
All right.
Dr. Lowry and Congressman John Lewis could not be here, but I think you heard from their words that they realize how important this is. I want to shout out to Columbia. Where y'all at? Towers. McNair is coming in. And is Cedar Grove. Okay. Now, out of all the seniors who plan on graduating on time, That felt a little short. At this time, I would like to bring up some very special guests. The civil rights movement has shaped our conversation regarding equality, education, race relations, and other topics. And here today to share with us are some individuals who have not only given blood, sweat, and tears to the movement and to our nation, we get the opportunity of a lifetime. When I tell you these are some of the greatest storytellers ever, they are. So I want you to pay attention. If you hear somebody say something that is something that can inspire you later on, then put it in your phone, make it a note, make it something you want to live by each and every day. I want to bring them up. I'm going to start with the ladies. Ladies, y'all here? Yeah. Ladies, are y'all here?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Act like y'all here. She is the founder, president, and CEO of the Trumpet Awards Foundation, Incorporated, and creator and executive producer of the Foundation's Trumpet Awards. The Trumpet Awards, of course, is a prestigious event highlighting African-American accomplishments and contributions initiated in 1993 by Turner Broadcasting. The Trumpet Awards has been televised annually and distributed internationally to over 185 countries around the world. Ladies and gentlemen, Ms. Xernona Clayton. Love her. Next up, she has been an advocate for civil rights since her youth, when she served as a secretary in the SCLC under the administration of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. She has dedicated more than three decades to advocacy and has since established a highly successful small business that is instrumental in forming strategic alliances that strengthen women's opportunities for government contracts. Ladies and gentlemen, Rita Jackson Samuels. On June 18th, 1964, black and white protesters jumped into the whites-only pool at the Monson Motor Lodge in St. Augustine, Florida. They wanted to force the owner of the hotel to leave because of discrimination. The owner poured acid into the pool. Among those protesters was our next guest, Mr. J.T. Johnson. I got a chance to go on a trip to Jamaica with some very distinguished clergymen. And you know how when you see somebody that's like tells a great story, you don't want it to end? When I tell you that this gentleman I'm bringing up, this young man, when he tells a story, he always says, and that's good stuff. That's good stuff. And I always greet him with that. Dr. C.T. Vivian is just amazing. In November of 2013, he was honored for his vision and leadership in the fight for justice when he was awarded the nation's highest civilian honor. So if you're not enlisted in the service, this is the creme de la creme. You can get no higher than this when he was awarded the Presidential Medal of Freedom. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. C.T. Vivian. Y'all ready to get into it? Yeah. Are y'all ready to get into it? Yeah. Do y'all want the truth? Yeah. From those who lived it? Yeah. All right. Let's get right into the discussion. We know now that race relations are very tense in America. Immigration, we hear about Black Lives Matter, and the decline of HBCUs have begun to become more frequent topics of discussion. I would open it up to our panel to talk about where they think race relations are in America.
Well, I guess I'll start this conversation. I don't think, I don't think we've gone very far as race is concerned. There's still a lot of racism in our country. And you know, some says that until the white preacher declare racism a sin from his pulpit, we'll always have it. I kind of believe that. You know, we have progressed quite a bit since the Civil Rights Movement, but there's still a lot of work to do, especially around race. You know, I was in St. Augustine, Florida, just yesterday, where we'd gone down to have a memorial service for the gentleman who was a dentist, Dr. Robert Haley, who invited us to St. Augustine in 1964, Dr. King and the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. And you know, they were struggling with some of the things that they needed to make this memorial service a success. And I asked them, had they said anything to the city about why didn't they take it on and why didn't they honor this man and make this possible for all of the good things that happened based on all the work he'd done in St. Augustine? Well, no one there had asked him. And they didn't do very much. So when a city like that, you know, the oldest city in our country, they poured acid on me in 1964, but they did nothing for Robert Haley in 2016. Don't make sense to me.
Well, I would just like to say good morning to you all. All the seniors, where are the seniors in here? Oh, let me tell you, I still remember when I was a senior. When I was a senior, I was happy every day. Are you happy? You know you're happy? Well, I wish you all the best of luck. I grew up in Mill, Georgia, in a place called Forsyth, Georgia. Not Forsyth County, but Forsyth, Georgia, which is Monroe County. It really was a college town because a college was located in Forsyth, Georgia. It was Tiff College. It was an all-girl Baptist college. And my cousin worked in the dining room at the college. And I decided when I graduated from high school that I was going to go to that college. So I don't know how my cousin did it, but she got me an application, and I filled it out, and I gave it back to her so she could submit it for me. And that was what she did. Well, about 2 weeks after that, my high school principal sent for me. And when I went into his office, he said to me, "Rita Jackson, I thought you knew. TIFF College will not accept black students." And I thought to myself when I walked out of his office, I thought, well, why didn't you fight for me? Why didn't you? This was my principal. But I knew back then that black men didn't do very much challenging of white men. That just didn't happen. You won't have that problem. I don't know if you can think of schools and colleges now that's not integrated. And if you have to fight for it, you have a lot to fight with, which at that time I had not met Martin Luther King Jr. I had not met these wonderful friends sitting up here. They are all responsible for me being the warrior that I am now. So, you know, I had to accept that. My grandmother, who reared me, said to me, "Keep your head up and just keep moving." So after 3 semesters at Claflin College in Orangeburg, South Carolina, I returned to Atlanta to work because we didn't have money to send me to college. And my uncle had met all of the people at SCLC. And he said, "I'm going to take you to SCLC and see if we can get you a job." And he did. And I was the secretary to the Operation Breadbasket Department. That was SCLC's economic arm. And it was composed of ministers, all these ministers. And I was the secretary to Reverend Fred C. Bennett Jr. He was the director. And so my duties and responsibilities included typing. I could already type, I typed good. And also sending out meeting notices to all these ministers. They had weekly meetings at a black restaurant on Auburn Avenue called B.B. Beeman's. And I would have to, they had old-fashioned addressogram. It was a machine that had a levy on it, and you'd had a little plastic, not plastic, but tin plates that you would, it had the name and the address on it, and you would put it in there, and then you'd have to pull the handle down in order for it to imprint on the envelope. Can you imagine that if I'd had a computer back then, or electric typewriter, but I didn't. And so I had to send that notice out every week. And I didn't understand why I had to do that, because they knew we had weekly meetings. And then I'll tell you something else I had to do. I did a lot of walking up and down Auburn Avenue, carrying food for these ministers. They would come to Reverend Bennett's office and they'd be hungry. So when anybody said they wanted food, they'd call on me, "Rita," and then I would have to go and get the lunch or get the afternoon snack or whatever. And I complained about it a lot. I didn't like that. But Xernona Clayton helped me understand. She said, "Listen, don't complain. Just go head on. Because what you want to do, you want to earn the trust of ministers. They'll be able to help you later on in life. So don't complain. Just go ahead and do it anyway." And so I did. Now, I had asked Reverend Bennett, my boss, I said, "When am I going to meet Dr. King? I've got something to tell Dr. King. I really need to meet him." And so he finally introduced me to Dr. King. I was so nervous, but I got enough courage to tell him what had happened to me with that TIFF college. Now, let me go further and say, God allowed me to live to see a black woman by TIFF College. And not only did she buy, but she made it a preparatory school, Yvonne Academy, because I remember you all gave them some equipment. And then my first time on the campus, because I had the pleasure and the good blessings of being the first black female to work in the governor's office when Jimmy Carter was the governor. But during this time, Jimmy Carter was in the White House and they had invited this college, Tip College, Mrs. Carter to come and get an honorary degree. And of course, when I worked in the governor's office, I don't remember telling them about my experience at TIFF, but when I found out that Ms. Carter was going to be given an honorary degree, I let them know what had happened to me, and my first time on that campus was with Mrs. Rosalind Carter, who was our First Lady of the United States. So God is good. You just have to do like my grandmother said. You got to hold on. And you got to keep your head up and you keep going. So I know that, and let me tell you, she had a lot of faith.
Miss Rita.
She had a lot of faith.
I know, Miss Rita, but you, I know, we're not done though. We're not done. I know, don't wrap it up. I know, Miss Rita.
Okay.
I know, but you're going to have to land that plane.
Did you enjoy
that? I enjoyed it immensely. But you had to land that plane. That's why they brought me here. Because I know, like, well, who going to say something? I'll say something. Where are the Grady babies? Make some noise. Grady babies. Okay, here's your piece of history right now. I want y'all to pay attention to this. You are going to find out why you are Grady babies. Ms. Clayton, would you please talk about the doctors and the situation that we have had happen and why they're saying Grady babies, but it almost didn't happen, but you were very instrumental in making sure that that was able to happen. This is history. Watch this. Listen to this part.
I want to, in a moment, I want to go back because there's a moral to read a story, and I will come back to that later, but I want to just take a moment to say those young people with that skit.
Wasn't that wonderful?
I would be so impressed.
Really,
they knew their lives, and they had, I just had to say that, how impressed I was with them. Well, when I came to Atlanta, everybody had to go, everybody black, had to go to Grady Hospital because the doctors could not practice in any other hospital in the city of Atlanta, and also in this area as well. But in addition to that, the treatment of black people, they had armbands that were yellow, blue, different colors, and what they represented was how poor you were. That was so dehumanizing to me, that you could sit there and say, well, I got $1,000 more than this one, this one's poorer than I am. What a way to treat people. And only Wednesdays were, and it's not as literally translated as this, but I made it so by saying that black women had to have their babies on Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
Because that was the day when black folk got the most services. Now, I've never given birth, but I understand babies don't decide to come on Wednesday. They come any day of the week, at any time of the day. When I found that out, I just could not rest until I decided that I must do something about that. So I called together the black doctors, and I had a group of other doctors who were part of my committee. There were five of us. There were only 66 doctors in the whole city of Atlanta. But we went to them and said that we've got to fight this issue. And the story is too long for me to tell you all the details, but we rallied the physicians together to say we got to change this. And we did, in terms of coalescing them. And every Wednesday afternoon, because that's usually the doctor's lightest work day, they don't work normally on Wednesdays. And we would march around the building that housed the Health, Education, Welfare Department. And then we attracted some attention, and finally we found out the same problems existed in North Carolina, in Florida. We said, well, let's make it a Southeast problem, and we did. But then I wrote President Johnson a letter, because President Johnson was considered a good guy. Mm-hmm. I wrote him a letter. He didn't answer it. We went to Washington with a press conference to saying that when I found out that these white hospitals were getting so much federal funding, mm-hmm. then I said, well, gee, the government is perpetuating racism. So that's when I wrote the President of the United States. We went to Washington, had a very, very large press conference, a pretty impressive. And that evening, I've never been known to be a shy person. They found that out at SCLC. So I said, you know what? I don't like it that we didn't hear from the president. And I said, he's a good guy. So I just kind of grandstanded a little bit and picked up the phone and called the White House and said, may I speak to President Johnson? Well, you can't get the president on the phone. I don't know why I even did that. But you know, when you just lack courage, you just pick it up and just said, the president's got to hear from me. Well, I told the lady the story that we were a group of black doctors from Atlanta, and we were having all kinds of servitude. Treatment was horrible in Atlanta, and the president didn't even give me the courtesy of a call. Didn't even answer my letter. And so we're not leaving Washington until we hear from him. Well, that was a bold statement, but you gotta be bold sometimes and courageous. Try something new. Can you imagine that in a half hour, the phone rang, and they said, Miss Clayton, this is the White House calling. I repeated it so my doctors could hear me. I said, the White House? And I said, yes. And they asked me, could I get the Social Security numbers of my delegation? And could we be at the East Wing, West Wing, whatever it is. Yeah. I don't go there that often. What is it, West Wing?
West Wing.
And could we be there in a half hour with all the Social Security numbers? And I said, of course. Well, we flew over there in the appointed time. Got a chance. We were escorted into a dark room. And a man came and said, the president will see you shortly. Well, my delegation was speechless, and so was I, because I didn't believe the president was really coming. But he came. And I told him how awful our treatment was in Atlanta. And I said, Mr. President, you're a good guy. And I know you haven't had a baby either, but you know that you've had some children, but they don't come on Wednesdays. And went on to tell him the story. And 3 weeks later, the president issued an edict that all the hospitals in the United States were desegregated, and black doctors could practice in any hospital they wanted in this city, in this state, in this country. Now, Cameron, that's the short version of a long story. It took more than what I'm telling you. But the moral of the story is that find a problem, and they're here. Pick a problem, not find it, they are here. Pick a problem and be willing to do what you can to help solve it. When we all pull together, you'd be amazed at what kind of results we can get. And reporters often ask me, like, if Martin Luther King could come back today and would see the president sitting in the White House who happens to be black, what would he say? I said, he would say, I told you so. And what he meant by that is that when young people, old people, poor people, rich people, blacks and whites pull together, the results could be unimaginable. And that's what happened. You remember the first election of the first campaign. Women, white women, were leaving their jobs so they could go and campaign for Mr. Obama. Children were given pennies, and you know the story. He won. That's when we pulled together. I'm concerned now that our country is pulling apart, that we're going in different directions. And until you make a commitment to pull together and coalesce and decide that you yourself can make a difference in our society, that's when we'll have a better world.
And now you know why you're Grady babies. So you can tell that story. You heard it from the person who made it happen. How about another round of applause? I'm going to move now to Dr. C.T. Vivian. Dr. Vivian, in, you know, we're celebrating Black History Month, but in recent news, we had a lot of African-American celebrities have come out and suggested there is no need to have a Black History Month. Give us your thoughts on the statement and why you think it's important to America and the world.
In the first place, we didn't start with a Black History Month. We really started with a Black History Week. It was so important that Black people all over America drove for a Black Month, all right? We now have a Black Month, but it's understood that every day you're Black in America. Every day you got to be involved in changing the condition. And that had my grandmother and my grandmother hadn't passed me one day, and I was reading a book, and she wanted to see which book it was, and she looked over my shoulder, and I was a kid, and she wasn't all that tall, right? But I looked over my shoulder, and she said, "Oh, those are race men." And I didn't know what she meant, but I knew what she meant, all right? She just walked on then toward the kitchen. But you see, the understanding is when do you start to really give yourselves to this major task of Black people? Because that's what's most important. You wouldn't be in a schoolhouse now if it hadn't been for race men, race women, that they were so concerned about all of the rest of us that they made certain that whatever it took, they were going to do it. I had a great aunt to die from pneumonia before there was a cure for it. She was out at night with food, feeding kids that were in the schoolhouse that she was teaching at. She was one of the lucky ones, right? She got to teach. I'll tell you how it was so you can see it as girls. Her husband, my great uncle, right? He had it all. But my grandmother, who was his sister, couldn't go to school. Right? And even as late as when I was in high school, right? Even as late as that, Black women couldn't go to the to the dormitory. They couldn't live in the dormitory, and I was at a state school. Right? Is that I want you to really understand how important being a race person is, all right? Is because none of the things that you have now would have happened if there hadn't been Black people willing to suffer for each other, and if there weren't for Black people willing to die for each other. If it hadn't been for that, you wouldn't be in a schoolhouse. In fact, if it wasn't for that, you couldn't have any guarantee for a job. You are at the top because everybody who was at the bottom below who you now are thought to see that you are who you are, all right? And that must never stop. It's because you are fortunate, but you must make the generation following you also fortunate. We must make each other fortunate. Can't depend upon anybody but us. And that's what you learn in America. Basically, what you learn in American history is that we all fought for each other to get where we are, all right? And anytime that stops, we're on our way down. You know, interesting thing is that if it hadn't been for everybody before me, a prize from a president, you know, the great thing about receiving an award from a black president was black hand. It was in black hand, right? Right? That when you really, and I see you got it, right? Or you wouldn't have been clapping, right? And that's it. Use it. Take it. Go beyond it. All right? Anybody who you think's anybody, go beyond it. Is because there's no reason not to, right? It's all before you. Is that it took generations of people to make it possible for me to be sitting here, for this, for every one of us to sit here. It took generations of people to make it possible that you can clap when you're thinking about your seniors in high school. It's because you couldn't have been a senior in high school. You know, the first high school you had, even in Atlanta, George Washington High. That's the first high school, but it was in the state. If you wanted to go to high school, you almost had to come to Atlanta. And you had to live with somebody who was a friend of somebody. Am I right, sister? See, I want you to understand that there's a great feeling in her and a great feeling in us that you don't have yet. Because you haven't done enough yet. Right? Go out and do it. Do it. Make certain you move it. Right?
On that note, Doctor, I want to tell these young people something. I built a school in Africa, and one time I was there, looking over the properties, and I was taken on a tour to a slave camp. And in this awful, smelly place, they showed us where over here in the dungeon, black men were tossed. Over here, the women were tossed, and the children were just thrown in the ocean. And they stayed there until they put them on ships and brought them to America. And that was the beginning of the slave movement. But during that slave time, there was a master, a white man who told the slaves what to do, when to do, and how to do. And told you, underscored the words, you're nothing, I tell you. Controlling the mind. And as time went on with modern civil rights, and you had, of course, you had Harriet Tubman and some of the other women who forged the battle, and then you came down to our modern civil rights, which we had as our leader, Martin Luther King, who said, you are something. You can be somebody. You're not controlled by a white master. There is another master, a real master, called God. And let him be your God. And as you sit here in these halls of hallowed, I call it hallowed grounds, called a school, you are in complete control of what you do. Nobody has to tell you. No master tells you. You tell yourself. Yeah. Look in the mirror and talk to yourself if you've got some problems. And say, I am somebody. And I can be a better somebody if I'll study and get courage and move forward. You can do it.
I want to share a little bit of my high school story. You know, I was an athlete in high school. And I'd like to think a pretty good one. But in 1954, in Albany, Georgia, I was born in Montezuma. I grew up in Albany. But the superintendent of schools, which was white, quite natural, they decided that any school teacher who was a member of the NAACP, they would get fired. So my scoutmaster told me, he said, well, you know, did you hear the story? I told him, yeah, I heard it. He said, well, we need to do something about that. So what I did, I went back to school and we literally shut it down. You know, we closed the school and said we will not go back to school if this happened ever anymore. So immediately, the next day, the superintendent of school changed his mind. But you know, growing up in Albany was kind of important to me because black people in Albany was real serious about, now we call it freedom. We didn't take very much from white people. You know, we just didn't, that was not our agenda. We would fight back, we'd do whatever we had to do until we met Martin Luther King Jr. You know, I left Albany, I went to Albany State University and got broke up as a football player, so I moved to New York. And watching with some friends in New Jersey in 1962, I saw all this action going on in Albany where all these kids were getting shelled around and beat up and locked up. So I said, well, you know, that's my home. I think I'm gonna catch me a bus. And I did. I left New York and went home to get involved. And I say all this to say that I thought it was my responsibility. So you have responsibility. You have to take these things on yourself. You take them on as they come on. You don't wait for anyone to tell you these stories. You really have to, if you see in Martin Luther King say injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. And we have to realize that anything is going wrong in your schools or your communities, you got to take it on. You take it on as young people. I was young, you know, it had a lot of energy. And we had to do it, you know, during the civil rights movement. Sometimes, you know, I was involved in most of all of SCLC's direct action. And we was the team that would go in first to make sure that everything was this and that. And when Dr. King got there, we mostly, CT had the crowd ready to go. But the thing, Leon Hall and Willie Bowles and the things that we would do, we'd close down high schools and put them all in jail. And we knew if we locked them up, their parents was coming to a mass meeting that night. So when Dr. King or CT or some of them came in, they had an audience full of adults. When they got through preaching to them, they was ready to go to jail themselves. But you know, in the 60s, young people led this movement. Don't ever let nobody tell you anything different. We might have been the ones organizing and in the front of these televisions when you saw us on the evening news, but it was young people in high schools and elementary schools who really made the movement what it is today. And this is your movement. We have two people I see sitting here, Donna and Bridget. We are part of what we call Take Two America. And we're working with young students in middle school, high schools, and elementary schools. You really have to get started early. You know, this country is not gonna change unless you change it.
That's right.
That's Jose Williams, you know, he said we changed the face of the earth. So it needs changing again. And we're dependent on you. You need to take it on because it's your responsibility.
Let me see my hashtag. You wanna stand up and hold that up? Turn around so everybody, if you wanna get that trending on all the social media, make sure the people know that you're here. Thank you.
What did it say?
Hashtag DeKalb, BHP. I'm assuming that's Black History Program. I know, I went to public school, I got it. I think, and I want to get your take on this, that three of the most deadly words that we hear for black boys is, boy, man up. When it's a young lady, when they fall down on the playground, what did the parents say? What's wrong? You all right? Why are you crying? Right, ladies? What's wrong? Black men, what do we hear? Boy, stop crying. Boy, man up. And what we have is a generation of young black men who are bottled up, who don't know how to express emotion, and better not cry. Yet, when they do reach a level but they're dealing with depression and things that they wish they could talk about, but they were told those three deadly words, boy, man up, they can't get better. The civil rights movement was full of emotions of African-American men. Talk to our young guys who have been told, boy, put that phone down. Put the phone down, bro. I don't know what game y'all playing, but you've been playing it for 15 minutes and it's disrespectful. Put it down and listen to these legends. I don't know who that is, but they ain't gonna get you into college. I'm not your friend. I'm a father of three. So I've been trying to be nice, but at this point, boy, if you don't put that phone down, I'm sorry. The emotions of the civil rights movement. We're told to hold it all in. Has anybody can say they honestly have good and bad days? By a round of applause, good and bad days. Some days it's great, and some days you're like, woo. How was that able to be organized when there are good and bad days and these individuals are going through more than just racism? They're going through cyberbullying and things happening at school and they're in the environment, and it has nothing to do with civil rights. Any of our panelists want to speak on that?
Well, I'm not sure that was the case. Did you all?
It was not the case.
You didn't have time to worry about whether anybody cried or not. You had work to do. Am I wrong? I don't remember.
Is that that? I never had. When I was in grade school, we fought each other.
Yeah. That's
right. They still do that now.
They still do that now.
Of course, I guess I'm a little older now than I was, but. I don't remember that. Those were not issues for us. No. I think I'm speaking. We had so much to do. You know what, when I remember one night we went into a Crystal, I'll call it now, Crystal hamburger place, had money in the pocket just to get a hamburger. And there were boys and girls, we were together, walked in, and that man picked up a long butcher knife this thing and said, if you don't get out of here, you know you can't come in here. I'll cut all your heads off if you don't get out of here. We were boys and girls, and we were all mad and embarrassed and insulted by that. You know, I don't think we had time to worry about whether you're male or female. You just, you know, it did something to your inner spirit. Someone tell you you're not good enough to come in the store. And I remember another incident that was similar to Mrs. Rosa Parks, who had already made her mark. And we were had a convention in, I think it was Jacksonville, Mississippi. And when she got off the plane, she said, you know, Miss Clayton, I don't think I bought the right clothes because I don't like air conditioning, and I don't think I got anything warm enough. And I said, oh, I'll get you a wrap because there's a store right near the hotel. So once I get you checked in, I'll go over. I went over to the store, had money in my pocket, and I was the only customer there at this time, and the lady was up with a back turn, and my assumption was that she just didn't see me. And I waited a moment, and then I knew she saw me. And then I said, Miss, I'd like this garment. And she said, you know you don't belong here. You people are always trying to start some trouble. All I want to do is buy a wrap, you know. And I'm not sure, you know, you do, Ron, I had on my show once Don Newcomb, who was in the Major League Football, basketball. Was it?
Baseball.
Some kind of ball. After Jackie Robinson, and he said, they were taught by the coach, like, you're going out here now, it's no longer just you, you're going out here now as a team, you're gonna play to win as a team, as a team, as a team. And they'd go out and play and win and come back, and then the team would eat over here, and he was put behind a closet, a curtain, because he was black. And he said, you end up talking to yourself a lot. Why am I not worthy? What's wrong with me? Why am I not good enough? And so those are questions that probe people's minds, male and female, but mainly men at the time, Ron, when you were just taught you were nothing. Wherever you went, you just weren't good enough. So you were so busy trying to figure out if you are good enough and why do people say you're not good enough that you don't have time to kind of butter up everybody to see whether you're crying or not. You got to get up and get going.
Well, Xernona, we were always working, but we had a good time, too. JT could dance. Remember when we used to have our Christmas parties? We had fun. I love all of the movement songs. I used to love to hear Dorothy Cotton sing, and she'd always raise a good movement song. So we had a good time, but now these issues, they do in fact exist. And I think what you have to do, see, for me, I was not gonna be discriminated against at that college and not one day do something about it. And so if you're discriminated against, if you know that there's a lot of bullying going on at your school, if you know that these young men want to do something and cry, yes, you do cry. When you said, we always tell them, maybe if you're a man, yes, you do. Get it out. So whatever it is you can do, and especially if a problem hits you, do something about it. Go to your principal. Go to the teacher. Say, let's organize a way to get violence out of this school. There's a lot of things that you can do and make a big difference. And especially, let me also say this, especially, you're not going to cut me off.
I put my microphone down. I'm not doing nothing.
You're not supposed to cut me off. So I'm just going to say this. But especially the girls, let me tell you, the women did not get treated equal in the movement.
We've never
been treated fair. So for the women, take a step forward. Know you can do it. Know what your power is. You have power. I used to get things done. If I started crying, I would cry. Well, I tell Jimmy Carter, I was up there in the state capitol, didn't see anything look like me. And so I went to him as a governor, and I said, Governor, why can't we do something about this capitol? The black people don't want to come up here. There's absolutely nothing in this capitol that looked like us. That's how Dr. King's portrait got in the state capitol. That was what I recommended that we do. And today, you go up to the capitol, the poacher's in there. But I cried. I cried when I talked to Jimmy Carter. They don't want you to cry.
You know, the other thing is that if you young people got busy, some of the bullying would cease, a lot of the fighting. There's too many other issues. You really have to involve yourselves in issues. You know, most of these kids I see walking around with the pants hanging down and all of this nonsense is not involved in anything. You have to get involved. There has to be issues at your school, and you really got to get involved in it. Once you do that, you don't have time to waste. You don't have time to do other things. You know, you take on your school. I took mine on. You have to take it on. You know, I used to run a 9-800. I was perhaps one of the fastest 100-yard dash persons in the state of Georgia. But I couldn't go to Georgia Tech. I couldn't go to the University of Georgia.
They didn't ask you.
So when I saw people in Auburn, Georgia, marching down the streets in this movement, I knew I was going home. Because I said, well, if I can't go, I'm going to make damn sure somebody can. And that's what I did. So, you know, that's what really got me involved in the movement, because I took on the issue that I couldn't go to school where I wanted to go. But somebody had to, and we made that change. So what you got to do is take these issues that you see in your schools, and you first go to your principal. And if they don't listen, then the demonstrations in an order. You have to mobilize your school and get your people involved. So I'm going to suggest that you take on your responsibility, because one day you'll appreciate it.
You know, I think this too, and this probably is a simplistic approach, but it could work. You try anything. Dr. King's philosophy was, unless and until you change a man's habits and change his heart, you'll never be able to regulate his behavior. Oftentimes, I think kids who participate in bullying got problems. And sometimes, if you could just take time to coalesce and pull this person together and find out what his problem is. Because obviously, hey, when someone just comes just for the purpose of fighting, he obviously has a problem. Change his attitude. It's a negative attitude, and change it, and maybe you can then regulate his behavior. That's simplistic, but I just worry when I see someone who's going to come in and just take over because he can. And I think people allow these bullies just to, you know, permeate and be strong enough to just take over. We need to do something about it. And I'm not sure all the time from what I can understand, a lot of the principals won't take the leadership either, and that's unfortunate too.
We have questions that have been on Twitter. People want to ask our panelists some questions. They've tweeted those.
Ryan, this question is from Ms. Gia Kirk. She wants to know, why should we only celebrate Black history for a month? Haven't we as African Americans done enough to build America into what it is?
Well, I think that's what we're talking about, a celebration. You do it every day. You celebrate the issues that is facing you. If you take on an issue, that's a part of Black history. I'm saying whatever you change in this country is a part of our history. No one is going to change it for you. You know, racism and segregation was real serious to me because you couldn't do anything. But, you know, in Albany, Georgia, during the winter months, they put you in jail if you was downtown in the overcoat. They thought you was down there to shoplift. See, these things are horrible. And I was not going to accept that for the rest of my life. I'd rather be buried in my grave than to go through those kind of intimidations. So,
and you got to see that.
Yeah.
If you're not willing to die for something, you really don't get it. All right? Yeah. When you see, we were at this for generations before we really had to face the fact of dying to be free. Not just one of us at a time, all of us. That's what nonviolent direct action was all about, all right? Is that you've got to stand up and fight for whatever you desire. When I say fight, I don't mean fist fight. I mean as a matter of spiritual life. I mean a matter of being, of desiring what you want so much that you'll fight for it. There's nothing that Black people have gotten in this nation that was given to you.
Absolutely. Hmm?
Remember that. Hmm? Everything we've got from the beginning to now, we fought for. And we didn't, that's exactly right. And we didn't start getting it until we learned to fight as a group. That's what Martin did for us. Remember, Martin was great because of what he taught us. Not just, and the other part of it was that he was willing to do what we talked about. It's in the action that you find out who you are and how much you've got on the ball. It's in the action. It is not just going to happen because you happen to go to school. It's going to be happen because you do more than go to the classroom, all right? Is that if Martin King was great because he had a method, and that's what you have to do as well. You have to see what plan are you going to use to get where you want to go, to do what you want to do. If you have no plan, if you're not, you're just going to go to school, well, that's not quite that easy, all right? If you want to be a lawyer, you don't get it by just saying, I want to be, all right? You get it because you're willing to struggle for it. And we have to struggle harder than anybody in this nation. Remember that, all right? We have to.
The question you asked, I think, and that's what Dr. Vivian was saying, but the first celebration of Black history. It was a week in 1926. That's what it was, a week. And then Carter G. Woodson got involved and was able to get the president to sign a proclamation to extend it to a month. So for those who do not want a month and don't appreciate having a month, go to work and change it. Get a proclamation up to our president and change it. How long would they like for it to be? It's every day. If you're a Black person, it's every day.
That's right.
You have a question in the audience? Raise your hand. Got a young man right here.
Yes, sir. Before I introduce, I can take the mic off. Hey, how y'all doing? Before I introduce myself, I want to say thank you. from the bottom of my heart.
Thank you, brother. Thank you. Thank you.
My name is Chandez Cook. I attend Towers High School. I'm a senior, and I plan on going to Alabama State University. I also have a passion for rap music. I'm kind of nervous right now. Y'all legends. I did my first time like really talk to a real legend in person.
That deserves a round of applause because you're the first one to get up.
I'm a rap musician. I'm so infatuated with rap music. Excuse me.
I don't know what he's saying.
Do you?
I've been listening to a lot of Tupac Shakur lately. And I noticed that even though he made gangster rap music, he made a lot of music uplifting our black women. And I look around and I see so much potential in our black women around here. Y'all so beautiful.
He's a politician, doctor.
Well, my question is though, there's no iconic figure that's to tell them that though. Like 9 times out of 10, when you turn on a rap song, they're gonna be disrespecting our woman more than they, you know what I'm saying. Talk like giving the respect y'all deserve sometimes, you know what I'm saying? Like you don't really got no iconic figure. So excuse me, I ain't done yet. And I heard Reverend Vivian, is it? Reverend Vivian, I don't want to say your name wrong.
Vivian.
Yeah, Reverend Vivian said that you're a black, I'm sorry, I'm nervous like I said. But Reverend Vivian said that you, he said that every day you wake up in America, you're a black American and you gotta change your condition. And my question is that if a person like me or a peer made more black positive music about our black women or anything, would it make a change 10 years from now? Cause I know you, like you said earlier, we got our black dudes walking around pants hanging. To be honest, I'm not really worried about them. They can save themselves. I'm worried about our black women. You feel me?
All right.
So
that was a question.
Yeah.
So like, it can't be a, you know, a book. We asked the question, now put the mic back. And listen, because I think for that
generation. What's the question?
The question was if he made a positive rap song, would it be around 10 years from now? The positive rap music, right? Would it make a difference? I'm going to say this because I do this every day.
Yes, sir.
I do this every day, and I'm going to say this to every person in here. If there's a song that is disrespectful, that you do not like, the power of the email will change the playlist. Not a phone call cussing nobody out, an email. And to all the young ladies, the music that you're dancing to, the telling you ain't loyal, telling you that it's going down in the DM, all those songs. Let me tell you something. As a father of 2 girls, the only thing you should be bending over for is them putting a gold medal around your neck. Anything else? You got to say, we're not going to accept that. Because every song is talking about how they're going to put something in your drink and what she'll do with the molly and all that. Then you should just get on a little email and be like, look, I'm tired of that. Take that off. Now, watch what happens. Now, brother, I want to hear this song that you say you got, but I'm going to tell you this. When people hand me music all the time, do not have 18,000 N-words in there. I get people that say all the time, man, I got this song, it's crazy, it's fire. First word, N-word this, N-word, where you gonna hear that at? You ain't hear no N-words on the radio, stop playing. Stop playing now, that's, you know, I don't know what station you listening to. Gone, I bet my check on that one. If you can prove that one. We have a 40-second delay. Anything that goes wrong, you hit that button and it goes away because we get fined for that. You know, it affects the paycheck.
That's one of the things we are doing at Take Two America, is that we are approaching these artists and asking them to make some other kind of songs. You know, it was songs that got us through the freedom movement. That we ain't gonna let nobody turn us around. We love everybody. All these songs was Negro spirituals, and it got us through the movement. It got us to where we wanted to be. So what if these artists, in Atlanta, Georgia, everybody lives in Atlanta, everybody. So why can't we depend on these, or go to these guys and say to them, we want you to create something of what Michael Jackson did some years ago. Let's create some freedom songs within the hip-hop community. We have got to sing our way out of this mess we're in. You know, if you guys demand it and say to them that we want to hear something different, you listen to the music. They don't get paid unless you listen. So why not say something to them positive if this is what you want to do? First of all, you got to make up your mind that you want these things. You have to make up your mind that you want to be somebody in this country that is recognized as a person who made a difference. But if you don't want to do that, it won't ever happen. So I go back to responsibility. Why finish high school? You see, when I left high school, he remembered me 30 years later. But I made some differences in high school. I changed a few things when I was in school. If you change things, and if you get involved in the right things, you show up at your 40th class reunion, people are going to know you, and everybody in your community will too. But until you do that, they won't remember you. Is there life after high school? Yes, it is. But you have to make that change. You have to make that difference. So we sit there with all of these kids in this room from about 5 different high schools. When we leave here today, we are going to be looking for you guys to do something very spectacular. We're going to be looking for you guys to make a difference in your high schools. We're going to be looking for you guys to make a difference in your community. And it starts with your pastor. Don't just go to church and say amen. You have to go to church and make sure that the church is talking about what you needed to talk about. I go to Olu Brown's church. I go to Impact. There's a lot of young people there every Sunday. But he's talking the language that they need to talk about. And they're involved in it. So you have to get involved in your church, your community, and your school. And if you do that, I guarantee you, your life will change tremendously.
Got a question over here. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Nikita Duffus from Cedar Grove High School. And okay. So, you know, we've started this Black Lives Matter movement, and I think it's an amazing thing, you know, that, you know, we've really been more aggressive about letting people know that Black Lives Matter. But I also have friends outside of the Black community, and sometimes they get upset because they're like, no, all lives matter. But then again, you know, there are these same people that are saying all lives matter, but they're so quick to want to pass these laws to get people other than, I mean, people who are not white out of the country. And so I'm saying, where there was an issue the other day about these Syrian refugees who were trying to come here to, you know, save their lives. But these were the same people yelling all lives matter, but they didn't want them here because of their religion. So I'm asking, what would you say to those people that are offended at the Black Lives Matter hashtag, the movement?
Could you tell us, what is Black Lives Matter? You say you think it's an amazing. So I just want to hear from your perspective, what really is it?
Well, I do believe that all lives matter, but not everybody believes all lives matter. That's why we have the Black Lives Matter movement, because what's been happening up until now in this country is people are saying all lives matter except for Black people.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that's why we have the hashtag, and that's mm-hmm. why we have the movement.
In fact, it's a matter of how you treat people. It's not a matter of how we talk about each other. It's is that all life matters only if you act like it matters, right? And what we're making the point is that white people think that white people matter, but they have never come to fully understand that Black life matters, all right? This is what's being said in the statement. White people want to play with it. All life matters, yeah, but do you treat all people like you treat your mama?
Right. Hmm?
If you don't, you don't really believe that all life matters. That's the idea. When we say it that way, that's what we really mean, all right? Everybody knows that life matters. Even dogs matter, right? The point being is life matters in all forms. The point is, do we treat people like life matters? And this is the thing that has to be said. And those who are saying Black Life Matters is because we have never been treated in America like all life matters, all right? Make certain they understand that, because they are getting by with just passing over the real intent of the idea.
One last question.
Good afternoon, everyone, or whatever. My name is Tyra Wisdom. I attend the Columbia High School. My question is, how are we supposed to make a change with Black race or as a unit? How are we supposed to make a change if we are not taught the importance of life? Black people, we go to school, we skip classes. We don't know the importance of education if we're skipping classes. We are not taught, as in the parents, we do not teach our children, Black people, what it means to go to school. Of course, you gotta go to school, but in terms of why go to school, yes, to go to college, why go to college? How are we supposed to make a change if we don't know the importance of school?
Or
education on a whole, I'm sorry.
No, but very truthfully, most of our parents send us to school because they think it's at school you're really going to learn why you have to go to school and how you're going to live if you don't go to school, as well as the best life comes with more education. The higher you have, the greater height you reach in education is the greater you're going to be in life, right? If you are sixth grade, you're never going to have anything. If you're just high school anymore, it used to be, I can give it to you another way. There used to be a time when if you went to school through the eighth grade, you could take care of yourself, right? Then it got to be high school. Then finally now we're at a situation where that in order to make life have meaning for you and to properly take care of your children, you're going to have some college. And it won't be long before you will have to have at least a bachelor's degree. And everybody with an education can tell you that right now, because they are only making it because they have an education. You don't make it without an education in this society. And it's going to come higher and higher and higher that you have to reach before you'll be able to make it, so you can own a house, so that you can take care of children, and so you can send them to school. Most of the guys that mess up with a woman and have children don't stay around. But why? Is because they are at a low level of education and they can't take care of the child that they bring into this world by accident in particular.
And you know what? We live in a very competitive society, and the best gets looked at. You just cannot make it without an education. You got to be good. Even getting an education, getting a degree is not just it. Okay. It gives you the qualification to go and said you've got some talent. But if you're not good at what you do, it still won't matter. I used to hire a girl. This was back in the days when they were using typewriters, and she ran late, and I just don't tolerate lateness under any circumstances. And so I said to her, she said, but I'm really fast. I'm good at the typewriter. I said, yes, but I don't know how good you are. You're sitting out on the highway. You got to come in here and let me see you type to see how good a typist you are. And if you're not, you just got to get rid of that and get someone who can. That's back in the old age. But today's world is still competitive.
Yeah.
You've got to compete in a society. And the ones who got it get more. You just don't lose. I mean, you can't win without it. It's simple as that. So sitting in these classrooms is more than just sitting in there warming the seats. You got to get something in your head.
You know, the other thing for that is that education is not just academic. You know, in Atlanta, in the metro area, we got $26 billion worth of construction going on right now. $26 billion worth of construction is going on in metro Atlanta as I speak. The thing is that the workforce in the construction business is about 60, 58, 59, and 60 years old. There's no young people involved. You have to go to school and try to figure out where can I be a success, where can I make a living, and how can I take care of my family. That's what education is all about. In the construction business, you need to get in it. You need to take a look. I'm talking about women and men. There's no very few black women in the construction business. I say there's $26 billion worth of work going on in Atlanta today. It's a field that I think you ought to take interest in.
We want to say thank you to our panelists. Let's keep the applause going for Rita Jackson Samuels, JT Johnson, Ms. Xernona Clayton, and Dr. CT Vivian.
Thank you.
And I know you want to say, well, what do we do now? What is the charge? What is the call to action? We want to bring up the CEO and president of the Stewart Foundation, Mr. Hank Stewart.
Oh, wow. First of all, y'all give Ryan a huge round of applause. Did he not do well? And then I want you all to give the CEO, give him another round of applause, because we talked about putting this on with these living legends. Dr. Green had to leave, and I want you all to give him a round of applause, our superintendent, for allowing you to get out of school and come and hang out with these legends. Dr. Ralph Simpson is up here, y'all. This is our Region 5 superintendent. Y'all give him a round of applause. There you go. There you go. And I might ask Tommy Ford to come on up here with me. Tommy, come on up. Tommy from Martin. Y'all know Tommy got a job at Martin. Yeah. And while he's coming up here, before I do anything, I want you all to get, now y'all, hold up, shh. I want y'all, you have four of, I'm telling you, these four, I have an opportunity to know each and every one of them, and I had an opportunity to have personal time with them. And every Tuesday, I get an opportunity to have lunch with this lady, and I've learned more from her over lunch. I mean, she's forgotten stories that's happened during the Civil Rights Movement. I mean, she is amazing. So I want you all to give Ms. Rita Samuels a huge round of applause.
Thank you.
Give her a huge round.
Thank you.
Mr. J.T. Johnson, I had an opportunity to be with him. And when I tell you voters' rights and actually advocating on behalf of young people, just left Jacksonville, Florida, working with our young people down there. That's my home city. Y'all give him a huge round of applause, Mr. J.T. Johnson. These last two, I've had the luxury of going to Ms. Clayton's office. If you ever have the luxury of going to her office is a museum. I mean, it really is a museum. I mean, it really is. And I had an opportunity to see pictures with her and John F. Kennedy and Robert F. Kennedy and Dr. King. And it's just amazing. If I was you all, I would try to become her friend real quick and try to get down there and see her office. Her office is just, I love sitting down. I love talking to her. Thank you for always, you know, supporting us. Thank you, Ms. Clay. Y'all give her a round of applause. The founder of the Trumpet Award. And Dr. Vivian, I had the luxury of going to his house. He's got how many, about 5,000, how many books do you have in your library?
I don't count them daily.
But he has the original of 13 years of slavery.
Yeah.
He's got all of the Langston Hughes, I mean, the entire collection of Langston Hughes poetry. I want to say it's Roots. Alex Haley signed a book to his friend. I mean, his house is a museum. I mean, just, so you have some amazing people up on this stage. And I don't want you to take for granted. I want you, when the CEO and I talked about this with Dr. Simpson, we were thinking about you. And that you had to have the opportunity to talk to these legends. So I want to do a piece of poetry. I'm going to let Tommy tell you, and we're going to have lunch. We got Chick-fil-A for you. Yeah. We got some definitely good food. But shh. I want you to hear this piece of poetry. And this poem is right. It's called, Are You Mad? Are You Making a Difference? I'm mad. But I'm mad about a lot of things. I'm mad about more than iced tea and Skittles hands up where I can't breathe. You see, I'm also mad about black on black crime. I'm mad about all the fighting and the dying over sneakers like Jordans and young people killing each other over a dime, or I'm mad. I'm mad about mothers leaving their young children at home alone and leaving them in hot cars. And I'm mad about men having to be held accountable to being fathers through legislation or law. I'm mad that we have to be encouraged to register and vote with all the blood that our ancestors shed. People like C.T. Vivian, Jiminy Jackson, John Lewis, Jose Williams, John Lewis, James Orange, and so many others were killed with billy clubs beaten over the head, or I'm mad. I'm mad that a lot of our churches are not what they used to be. I'm mad that a policeman can shoot and kill innocent black people and then walk away free. I'm mad that we don't eat at black restaurants and shop at black stores. And I'm mad that the people who came before us, like corporate America, helped us get through that door. I'm mad. I'm mad that young ladies are getting pregnant without ever thinking about marrying the father. I'm mad that young men are getting these young ladies pregnant and moving on to the next one like the last one was just a bother. I'm mad that adults or children don't say thank you or please. And I'm mad that we're not teaching our young people work ethics like cutting grass or raking leaves. Or I'm mad that in Africa, little kids don't have shoes. I'm mad that people like Clarence Thomas, Stacey Dash, oh yeah, and Charles Barkley don't have a clue. I'm mad that during Christmas time, people can give gifts without ever saying Christ. I'm mad that homeless people won't get pennies but walk right into the store and buy red bottoms, rims, and jewelry without even looking at the price. I'm mad that the Democrats and the Republicans both seem to be the same, services being cut and deleted while Congress and Senate up on the Hill playing games. I'm mad that we're listening and dancing to music that degrade our women and that athletes won't band together for a civil rights cause. Don't they know they're more than what they do on a diamond turf or court running, throwing, or shooting the ball? Yeah, I'm mad that some young men have chosen to sag over wearing a suit. I'm mad that we picket and protest in our own community that we burn and loot. I'm mad at cancer, and I wish cancer would get cancer and die. I'm tired of cancer taking our loved ones beyond the sky. I'm mad that parents can find time to do almost anything and everything and can't find time to go to a PTA meeting at the child's school. I'm mad that we're losing our history. By the way, I'm still waiting on my 40 acres and a mule. I'm mad that the Montgomery boycott, march on Washington, and Selma all seem to have been for naught. All the civil rights leaders were lost during that era, not to mention when Malcolm, Marion, and Martin were shot. I'm mad that we don't have a bill for the Voters' Rights Act, and we're not even talking about it. But let something happen with an entertainer on social media, it blows up how easily we distract. Yeah, I'm mad. I'm so mad. I'm mad. I'm mad that each and every one of you all are not mad. How could you just sit there? And if we're not careful, what we have will be what we had. Well, I'm going to keep on fighting and grinding, trying to live a life of substance, because Edmund Burke said it best. The only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is for good men and women to do nothing. But I'm still mad. Are you? If so, what are you going to do? Mad. Make a difference. Be mad. Be mad. Be mad. Real quick, tomorrow something is happening that I want you all to do, and Tommy's going to come and tell you about it. Tommy, come and tell them about what we're doing tomorrow.
Hello, everybody. How are you? Wasn't this an awesome, awesome day? Let's give our guests a great big round of applause. I want to share something with you. How many of you have ever seen the Martin Show before? Okay, hands down, hands down. They used to say that Tommy didn't have a job, right? Well, I want you all to know something. I got a job now. But get this. There's a difference between my job and my occupation. My occupation, the things I do to get a check, but when I'm doing my job, I'm doing what I am born to do. Black History Month is one of the times we celebrate men and women who understood what they were born to do. They were born to change, to be great, to be amazing, to be awesome. When you heard our wonderful speakers speak today, they talked about change. They talk about doing something. Faith without works is dead. You can't sit on your behind and wait for something to change. You have to make a difference, make a change. Tomorrow we have an opportunity for you to make a change in your lives so that we can celebrate you during Black History Month. We heard our guests talk a lot about education and the importance of education and how it helps advance us, our lives, so we can be agents for change as well. We're doing a scholarship fair tomorrow at McNair High School. Now, there's a difference between a college fair and a scholarship fair. A college fair is when you go to meet colleges, you could potentially go to school and learn about them. Well, a scholarship fair is where you go to receive a scholarship that night. Last November, we were at Cedar Grove High School. And we did a scholarship fair. And we gave away over $5 million of scholarships in one night. In one night. Tomorrow, you have an opportunity to make a difference. Don't wait for a difference. To make a difference. You can show up at McNair High School from 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock to meet colleges, and you could potentially receive a scholarship on the spot. The name of the organization is Infinite Scholars. Infinite Scholars. I want you to go on your phones, and I want you to go to infinitescholars.org, and I want you to register today. I want you to prepare for change to make a difference today. And tomorrow, Faith Without Works is dead. Show up and get a scholarship. I'm going to be there. Hank and I will be hosting this event. We will be celebrating you. We'll be encouraging you. Go to infinitescholars.org and register today. We're going to have some flyers in the back of the lobby for you so you can have that information so that you can make a change, so that you can make a difference, so you can invest in your own lives because it's your job. Our job is to be about our Father's business. God bless you. Thank you so much.
So we're getting ready to go and have lunch, and we're going to, those of you who didn't get an opportunity to ask a question, if you want to hang around and take a picture, Lee, our CEO, wanted to make sure we did that. Come on up, CEO, come on. We had an opportunity, when I remember when he called me, when was that, last month, and 2 months ago, about doing this, and and his team, you got to give the DeKalb County team, give them a round of applause. I mean, Demetrius, Nicole, Diamond, and everybody, I mean, worked really, really hard. The whole team, Bert. So please show them some love. Give them another round of applause because this is going to be, it's airing on CNN right now and all of that. So here's what we're going to do. And I'm going to turn it over to CEO May. You want to say something before I tell them which way to go for lunch?
Y'all be great. That's all I'm going to say. Be great. You got everything in you to be great. And I just want to thank all of our panel for doing what you do and being who you are. God bless you. We love you.
Dr. Simpson, come on up and just... Okay, are you good? Okay. Y'all give Ryan another round of applause. Thank you for taking off early, leaving the station to do what you do with us, man. Thank you, Ryan. I appreciate that.